Welcome back to this final hour of Hereticus, the campaign, not just this episode. So here's the thing: we'll do a bit of fast forwarding, unless there's anything you guys specifically want to roleplay. We'll fast forward to that big day when the Inquisitors gather for their conclave. And Sister Francesca, you're summoned to this great event.
Yes, and once she turns up, that goes without saying.
Yes, and so the conclave is held in this. So they're compensating for something. It's that massive a chamber.
And oh, that's what was the Wig Lady was doing.
Maybe.
It's ostentatious.
Yes, indeed, and it's filled with all kinds of religious iconography, and the inquisitorial eye, of course, is displayed prominently throughout the entire chamber. And there are these dozens of thrones, all of them made of precious metals, none of them golden, but other metals. And on these thrones sit the inquisitors of the Calixis sector, or rather those of them who are able to attend this conclave. Because, yes, as we all know, inquisitors are busy people, and they are quite often out in the field doing inquisitorial work. But the ones that are able to attend are there, and they are as varied as you might expect. Some of them are dressed garishly in the latest fashions and electus and all kinds of weird jewelry, while others are dressed entirely pragmatically, wearing their power armor, basically looking as if they're ready to march into battle. And on the largest throne of them all sits the Lord Inquisitor. This time he is wearing his mask. And there's a great murmur as the inquisitors speak amongst themselves, discussing inquisitorial stuff. But when there's a choir somewhere in the chamber, you can't quite see it, but there's no doubt that there is a choir, and this choir begins singing an imperial hymn. And this basically marks the start of the conclave, and so every inquisitor shuts up, and all focus is given to the all attention is given to the Lord Inquisitor, and he rises from his seat and addresses the conclave. He makes a long and what's the word I'm looking for? Inspirational.
Boring.
No, it's actually quite the opposite, because even though it is long,
stirring.
It's a stirring speech about the Inquisition's accomplishments throughout the time since their last conclave and this one, and how the Imperium is advancing on all fronts and purging the unclean and whatever else the Inquisition might find enjoyable to discuss. So he's holding this stirring speech, and he does also mention the Iriax shots and and your success as inquisitorial agents. He only mentions Sister Francesca, and he angles it as if she basically did it all on herself, all on her own. He's basically selling her at this point to the other inquisitors, and the idea that she herself should be an inquisitor. He's basically including that in his speech. Once that's done, and there are various pauses where members of the ecclesiarchy also hold their own sermons, and fallen inquisitors are remembered, and so on and so forth. It does come down to the vote, because apparently that's how they do things in this conclave. It's a vote thing, and so all this time, it should be mentioned, Sister Francesca, you've been standing in the center of this room, just staring.
Yeah, imagine.
Of all these inquisitors.
Oh, yeah, not tense at all.
Nope. It does come down to this vote, and there are some naysayers, but overall the vote is positive, and it does actually end with a possible a positive outcome for the Lord Inquisitor, as the vote is that that Sister Francesca is inducted into the Inquisition as a junior Inquisitor, and that she be given the rank and the power of such. And that is followed by yet more religious hullabaloo by members of the Ecclesiarchy. And Sister Francesca, the only part where she's actively a part of this is when she's given her inquisitorial rosette as an inquisitor, and she is formally included in this exclusive club that is the Inquisition.
At that point,
yeah,
when she is, if you would, free to move, she will have taken note while she was standing there, you know, stone faced in the center. She would have taken note of what factions are sitting where, because there are factions, as we all know, in the Inquisition. They're very, very much a fractious lot.
Yes, they are.
And she will have taken note of where the Amalathians are and where the Monodominants are and so on and so forth. You know, basically trying to figure out who sits where.
Right. So it's worth mentioning in this regard that during the vote, any Inquisitor who has something to say can say it, and I think this is also partly where she's able to gauge where are these groups sitting, because they each have their own way of addressing either a positive vote or a negative vote towards Francesca. Based on their own leanings in regards to the Inquisition. So yeah, definitely.
Good. Well, when she can then move after she gets the rosette and she's officially inducted, she looks at everyone in turn, and then she, without a word, she moves over to where the Thorians are sitting.
Cool. And she takes a seat, or?
Yes, if, you know,
there is an empty throne for her.
Yeah, there is an empty seat. Yeah. Then she takes a seat there.
Cool. Well, so this pleases the Inquisitor sitting there, of course, but it also she does notice that there is quite a bit of disappointment, no, and
there always will be
anger among some of the Inquisitors, and now they know where she is on the political spectrum.
Yes.
So she's kind of made her. Her own leanings known at this point. So yeah, cool.
Yes, best get that out there straight away.
Yes, and finally, after hours and hours of votes and speeches and sermons by the Ecclesiarchy and so on and so forth, and also discussing the future, they do also discuss actual matters of inquisitorial matters. Definitely. So this is her first real taste of what it is to be an Inquisitor. And she since she is a junior Inquisitor, she's included in these matters as they discuss.
And she will weigh every word exceptionally carefully.
Yeah, absolutely. Cool.
Oh my goodness, this is not the time to make a boo-boo.
No. So eventually the conclave adjourned, I think is the word. Ended.
Concluded or
concluded
whatever.
Concluded is a better word.
Alliteration.
Yes. And the Lord Inquisitor approaches Sister Francesca. So all the other Inquisitors are filing out or standing in their small groups discussing and stuff. She's approached by the Lord Inquisitor.
Yes. She, of course, she you know, bows respectfully her head to him because he's the Lord Inquisitor and she's junior.
Yep. Well, that went well.
I believe so.
And feeling?
I must. I would say that the seriousness of the situation impacts me. This is an overwhelming honor, but it is also a tremendous responsibility, the greatest responsibility any servant of the God Emperor could hope to be to be given.
Indeed. Indeed. Did you know that the Inquisitor who ordered exterminatus on the planet He all those years ago was a junior Inquisitor? Did you know this?
No, I didn't.
Oh, well. So, there are many practical things for us to get through at this point. You'll need various clearances. We'll need to fill up your accounts so you have some monetary resources to spend. You'll need to figure out how to create your retinue. I'm going to assume that you have your first few agents in
absolutely. Mind.
But that is something you'll be spending quite a lot of time on in the near future. And then once all that is done, I will summon you and we will speak about your first mission as an Inquisitor. And I should say that I won't be giving you missions from time to time. For as an Inquisitor, it is very much up to you to find evil yourself.
Absolutely.
But
I already have a few leads, but I will wait with them until your mission is taken care of first.
Yes, indeed. I do have one in mind, but I will get to that eventually. Now, settle in. I think they've assigned your former Inquisitor's quarters to you. So you.
Thank you.
And you'll need a quartermaster, of course. You'll need various other staff to man those quarters.
Indeed.
So I won't be keeping you. Like I said, I will summon you eventually and we'll discuss details.
Yes, my lord.
Excellent. And with that he nods.
Yep.
And leaves your presence.
Yes. Francesca goes a little, you know, somewhere to herself for a few moments. And she folds her hands in prayer and sends probably the single most heartfelt and sincere prayer she's ever said to the God Emperor through the intermediaries of her parents.
Okay. So... Also, one thing I was wondering, do you think is she still a part of the Sisters of Battle, or does she leave that order as she becomes an Inquisitor?
When you become an Inquisitor, you have to leave the order because you can only really serve, you know, one order at a time. The Sisters of Battle are what are they called? They are the armed forces of the ecclesiarchy, but they are also closely aligned with the Inquisition.
Yep.
So you would be closely aligned with yourself, sort of. It would be quite weird.
Yeah, I agree. Cool. So yeah, that's also something that's been taken care of at this point.
Yes, and of course she makes sure to return all her equipment because that is the property of the order and should be put into use by a new Sister of Battle.
That's sweet, sweet power armor gone. Yes. How on earth will you cope without it?
Oh,
she does have an endless bank account at this point. So.
I was about to say, I will request a new one.
Yep.
Yes, better one.
So yeah, cool. So what happens next? Where do we see? Do we see Francesca go back to the others, or?
Yes, no question that she goes back to the others.
Okay, and meanwhile, what have the others been doing? So you guys know that Sister Francesca has been at this this gathering of inquisitors, and it's you also know that they've voted regarding her inclusion into the Inquisition, but you don't know the results, obviously. But what, right. What have you been doing while she's been away?
Adair has done some. She doesn't do a lot.
Oh.
She's thinking.
Thinking deeply.
Oh my.
Yes.
So about it's horrible.
About the Lord Inquisitor's offer?
Yeah.
Cool. Awesome. Cool. Sweet. Cool. So yeah, Sister Prince. Or what about the others? I should say, Acalon, Prue.
I think Acalon would have been engaging Prue regarding discussing their future. What you know, what they can expect if they are to become, Inquisitor Canisani's agents. It's so weird because now I know I should call her that, but you just really keep saying Francesca, don't you?
Yeah.
But yes. What it means for us, what sort of thing we can expect going forward, whether our relationship with her is going to have to. I mean, there will be some changes for the sake of decorum, but will she expect us to address her differently? Things like that.
Right. So you'll basically be discussing the future.
Yes.
He will have found Prue to be very literal-minded about a lot of the things. Or it's like, how do you think things will change? There's no reason to think about that until we have all the facts.
Mm-hmm.
Very, I wouldn't say reassuring, but...
No, but of course, no one in the Adeptus Mechanicus likes to speculate without having all the relevant data, do they?
Probably not.
Towards the end of it, yeah?
Yeah, go on.
Towards the end of it, Acalon will actually then eventually turn to Medea and say, "You're giving thought to the Lord Inquisitor's offer, I assume."
There will be silence as she's staring at whatever she's been staring at for a while. Then, what?
Giving some thought to the Lord Inquisitor's offer, I imagine.
Yeah.
And what is your thought?
I don't know how to get my answer to him.
I mean, I would worry less about the practicality of it and just what the actual answer is going to be. I'm sure we can manage getting the response to him through Francesca, if no other way.
Seems rude to just tell him like that.
It's all a matter of practicality, really.
You sure?
Yes, the Lord Inquisitor is nothing else a practical man. If he wasn't, he would not be the Lord Inquisitor. So don't worry about how he will receive the message. Merely consider the content of the message. Good grief.
Okay. What have you decided, Medea?
I'm not entirely sure yet. I'm still weighing the pros and cons. I've gone 200 and something on both ends now.
That is quite a lot. I should like to hear.
She looks at Pro. That would take too long.
Well, it's not like we've got anything else to do. And I'm quite good with pros and con lists.
You make them yourself?
It is an easy way to decide something. Of course, it's simplified, but... I tend to involve mathematics if I can.
I'm better at math than I am at other things. A surprising statement coming from Medea, but it is true.
Prue elects not to comment, but she's thinking that's a nonsense statement. In that, I'm better at jokes than I am at other things. It doesn't really tell you much. But she elects not to comment. She's been told that's polite.
She didn't really bother with that on the thingy, though.
No, she's learning.
Yes.
She has to adjust people and their sensitivity.
I suppose it might come down to whether or not it's what your mind says versus what your heart says.
Sorry, go on.
My heart doesn't speak. It doesn't have a mouth.
Yes, but you have a soul. And the soul is, in many ways, while a part of you, separate from your physical form. And it can... Its responses are not the same as one's mind. At least not always.
She still looks like she's figuring it out.
I would advise you to use your head. Weigh the different options, give them values, and see which side comes out having the greater value.
You'll make it so easily logical. Thank you, Prue.
You're welcome.
All right. I should find a way to answer him then. She gets up and leaves the room. Actually, forgetting to say if you're staying or not.
Well, so I think it's at that point that Sister Francesca actually returns to the others.
Bump.
Bump, indeed.
Opens door, face to Fatima?
Yes.
Ow. Hi.
Hi.
Since you said yes, I'm going to assume that means that they consented to your...
She takes out her inquisitorial rosette to let them see it.
Yay! Medea claps.
Congratulations, Inquisitor Canisani.
Congratulations.
Thank you. We have a lot of work to do.
Yes.
That is to say, I have a lot of work to do, but should you... The three of you wish to stay with me, I will have an awful lot of work for you to do as well.
Well, I should get my answer to the Lord Inquisitor first. I think he'll get annoyed if I let him wait too long with an answer.
Probably.
Mm.
Yeah.
I hope your answer will be... Well, it'll be the right one regardless of which one you give him. I just hope it'll be one that benefits me. Because I can sure use your abilities.
Medea offers her a smile that's also a little sad as she leaves the room.
Right?
And goes to find a way to answer the man.
Hmm.
How does one do that?
Well, she has been asked for a personal, for her to give him an answer. Yeah. So, if nothing else, it should be possible to leave a message for him. You know, if not, get a personal audience.
Mm.
Yep.
Yes. Well.
So yeah, there are plenty of ways for Medea to get the message across, including just sending or. Oh, I was about to say text him, but that's not quite
how it works. A weird contraption in the corner says,
yeah.
Beep, beep.
But yeah, send
and
some
kind
of written...
And then shortly after, do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do.
Yes.
But yeah, that's definitely doable. But the important thing is that Medea does decline his offer, I take it. Or what is her answer?
Depending on how she actually gets to answer him. Politely decline his offer, but if he in the future would still want her, she shall give it another thought.
Okay,
but
cool.
For now, Sister Fred, screw this. She stands for a moment. What is it her name was again? Canisani! Yeah. Junior Inquisitor Canisani will need her help.
Okay. So that's the answer she gives. She doesn't get a response unless, of course, she's... Well, so I don't even think she gets a response if she tells it to him in person. She's just... Someone indicates that she can leave now. Maybe your door was closed. Maybe a bridge has been burned. Who knows? Only time will tell for Medea in regards to the Lord Inquisitor. Cool. Well, yes. So my question is there anything specific you guys want to roleplay here toward the end? And anything you need?
Actually, I think it's a beautiful place to end it.
Yeah. Okay.
No, did you have anything?
No, it's just one last thing. Of course, is Apollon's response to Fatima's saying whether or not we're going to be staying with her is that it's for him to say, well, I've not really got anywhere else to be. It's not like I can go back home. It's not like I can just enter the workforce with your danger. But, you know...
Acalon, we've been at each other's throats for quite a while on several different issues. There is no way I'm putting this to you as delicately as I can. There is no way I am letting Inquisitor suffer your barbs and your willfulness if I can do something about it.
My willfulness is a symptom of the school of the psychic discipline I've chosen to invest myself in. I fear I've heard that many telekines end up becoming willful, but there is no one else I would rather work alongside and serve than you.
Thank you.
I think Medea comes back. Okay, we had work to do. You said.
We do indeed.
Cool. So unless there's anything else, we'll fast forward a bit. Francesca, you've been summoned to the Lord Inquisitor to discuss Inquisitor Canisani. You've been summoned to the Lord Inquisitor to discuss your first mission, and so I think we'll close this campaign because we need to make the closure vague enough that we kind of sort of tell our viewers, our listening audience, that there may be a sequel somewhere in the future. So we'll close this campaign with an image of you and the Lord Inquisitor in some kind of briefing room. You probably have a glass of Amasek in front of you, and in the center of this table there is this hollow pict of a skeletal figure in a black armor.
Yes.
And, on that, ladies and gentlemen,
bastard needs to go.
Yeah. That's the end of Hereticus. So
yay!
Weird. We almost all survived.
Almost all survived. We lost one, yeah.
Ours must be the lowest fatality rate of any Dark Heresy game in all of history.
So, I just imagine the rest of the team standing outside, along with Wig Lady and Medea with a big grin on her face looking the other way.
I mean, let's face it, with an unlimited budget and a couple of however long it's been, Fatima could have given Medea some new threads to make her look a bit better.
Yeah, maybe.
And a wig.
And a wig of her own. Okay, it wouldn't be done up.
She would have tried to kill whoever tried to put such a wig on her head.
I mean, it wouldn't have to
she
be.
She
like
would a... think it was trying to eat her.
Yes, I mean, it doesn't even have to be like a full on, like, done up court wig. It could just be like a Lady Godiva hair cascading down.
Yes.
Everywhere.
No, I don't think that she would make Medea wear a wig. I don't think that she would, but she would certainly make sure that her personal retinue is suitably attired.
Yes.
If she tries to put a dress on Medea, she will hiss at her.
Not a dress, but good quality clothing.
Yes.
Good.
Probably.
Don't you want a dress?
Nope. All right.
So yeah. That's it for Hereticus. That's it from us for now. I have heard some rumors of dark clouds gathering over the Imperial city of Upus Reich, but We'll have to see what happens there. So.
Ooh, that sounds really serious.
So, yes. For now, ladies and gentlemen of the listening and viewing audience, it's been a pleasure to have this Warhammer 40,000 campaign for you guys. So, until next time. Bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye. Bye.